Let me say good morning to everyone and welcome to this beautiful facility. United Negro College Fund, Dr. Long shared with you that I currently chair 37 member institutions. I'm the vice chair of the board of directors of UNCF and now serving my second term, one more term to go. UNCF was founded in 1944, right in the state of Alabama, right at Tuskegee University. Talladega College was one of the first six institutions that were member institutions of UNCF. This grant was granted to Talladega College as one of the innovative grants that they have awarded to our member institution. You know, my career, okay, has been about education. And so it's very near and dear to my heart and the importance of instruction in the classroom. And so that's why you all are here. That's why you all are working with this grant, because you are working to try to connect the student and the teacher.
Everybody. The purpose of our lesson is, everybody ready? Here's your question to think about. I want you to think about your moral principles. What are they? What are your moral principles as a teacher of children every day regarding your choice of instructional materials? Now, you may walk into a classroom that has big packages of materials, or you may walk into a classroom like the first one I walked into with nothing. But you also have discernment about what is good for students. My question to you today is for you to question your moral principles, question what you're learning. And we're actually going to do a deep dive today into the four corners of this room. A further purpose of this lesson is for you to commit to actually building the social, the emotional, and the intellectual growth of yourself as a teacher. That's straight from the Alabama State Standards, the Alabama Core Teacher Standards. The standard also says to monitor yourself through ethical and unbiased selections of books and materials that mirror the children in your classrooms. Now, I want you to talk right now to the people at your table about what does that mean to you? What is that standard? What does that mean?
It's saying that we can, what we learn here, we can take that
in the
work field or in our own environment, you know, as well. And try to bring out that multicultural, in other words.
Yeah, they need to be able to see themselves in the literature, regardless of their background or their gender or their economic background or anything. They need to see themselves in the literature that you have in your class. So you need to have a very diverse selection.
Now, lesson study participants, if you feel like you need to move closer, you can't get too close because of COVID. But if you want to walk like I'm walking and pick you out a couple of students to listen in on, that is permissible during lesson study. Is there anybody that heard something at their table that they feel like they want to report out, or anything that you feel compelled to say about your response to your moral responsibility in selection of developing your own professional learning in your books?
Well, we were just discussing the need for diversity in our libraries as teachers. We need to know our students, the community that we're teaching in, and what they're coming from. And they need to see themselves in the books that you provide for them. If you're in a town and your classroom is going to be majority African-American, then your books need to be African-American authors and illustrators.
So you're going to the corner, and this is an active learning strategy that's in your packet called Four Corners. There are four brilliant people. Rudine Sims Bishop, one of my favorites, Alfred Tatum, Jacqueline Woodson, and a Miss Milner is over in this corner. You're gonna read, you're gonna write, you're gonna talk.
She's stating that she likes the first part where she talks about how growing up her and her mom struggled. They weren't poor, but they had to survive. So they did what they could to survive. And it was a book that she like called Match Girl. Yeah. Go ahead and finish. Because I didn't get to go all the way down.
Oh, it was called Little Match Girl. The girl had to sell like matches and stuff to get money for her family. And she just said that the book didn't end like happy like most books. So she wanted to read a lot of books so she can write a happy ending for the little girl in the book.
She wished Little Match Girl had a happy ending, but she didn't.
But basically, she used to read other books, and it was always a happy ending. So she wanted to make a happy ending for her.
Saying, I'm going to work with you. Alfred is my favorite. Why did you choose Alfred?
One thing is the reasons to read. I was going to put here is that the reasons to read is because he was saying, I can't remember who made the statement. I think it might have been you, Doc, that you said reading don't make you smart. It's being a reader. You become smart, some sense of that nature.
It impacts you.
It impacts you, correct. So this is what he's trying to say to the students, you know. He don't want you to just be smart, but he wants you to be a reader and becoming smart and knowing your environment. And yes.
Basically, what Denise Milner talks about is a little girl who's overcoming her stage fright and performing in front of a church, Mm-hmm. And how I related this story to Ruby Bridges, because, you know, Ruby Bridges, at the time, she was going through a segregated situation between transitioning into a predominantly all-white school and living in a black community. So how Milner and Ruby Bridges connected, that really transpired the whole event.
Again, our person is Denise Milner, and the question that we want to answer is why you do it and why you choose it, and how does she impact you as a teacher? She gives us a lot of courage to be great teachers, to embrace our new students that come in that may have the same jitters as we do. And her books help us to feel comfortable, to encourage our students to be brave and stand out. And Ms. Milner also works stories about everyday beauty of being a little human being. And she also wanted to write books to reach all students, not just black, white, all students. And I like Ms. Milner's passion, how she had a desire to connect with everybody.
The picture I drew was what we felt like Ms. Denise Milner made her classroom feel comfortable and connected. So I made a bookshelf. Different authors and different books to where students can connect or find a connection to those books.
We wrote on there that, you know, on the little bullet points, we said that Ms. Milner, she makes you feel comfortable, open, and motivated to push you to be a better person, to step out of your comfort zone. And right now at this moment, we're stepping out of our comfort zone, speaking in front of everybody. Thank you so much.
So I'm going to open up with the quote that stood out to me, what she said. She said, literature transforms human experiences and reflects it back to us. I chose that quote because children, when they read books, they can compare the book or books to their daily experiences or lives. So I chose that quote. It stood out to me. And we did a picture. This is the window. And we did the window because with the sun, with the rays, because She mentioned something about the glass door.
And the sun rays were, it comes from the quote down here. These windows are sliding glass doors. And readers have only to walk through imagination to become part of whatever world has been created and recreated. And so the first thing that came to my mind was a big window, a child, don't look at the child. The child.
Is it a sick girl?
He's pitiful. Looking through that window and going, I can do that, I can do that. And the rays of sunshine that comes through, when you have books in your library, in your classroom, that child can see them as they read that book. She said in some of her works, she wanted to include all races and genders and areas of employment and things that children can look up to and inspire to be. She was all about inclusion, her community, then being able to reflect back, like when they read a book, their imagination can just go wild as to what they can be. They can be, everybody can be teachers, police officers, astronauts, authors, poets, scientists, lawyer, doctors, and firemen, anything you want to be, you can do that, no matter what diversity or whatever that you are labeled as. You don't have to be your label.
Dr. Tatum was an eighth grade teacher and later became a reading specialist. But he also discovered the power of Texas to reshape the life of outcomes of struggling readers. To me, that hits home because to me, I don't think I'm a struggling reader, but I know I can advance, you know, in my reading material literacy. But I chose him because he had a lot of points that stood out to me.
And she's made these little neat little things right here, tags.
The first one is Reasons to Read. And one of his statements or paper that he had was that they say, you know, most of the time teachers say the kids just don't want to read. You know, that's like one of the reasons the teachers say, the main reason, you know. Or, you know, they get some kind of excuse. But Tatum states that presenting textual lineage, meaning, you know, give meaning, give kids a reason to read so they can see themselves within that book. And that will motivate even a struggling reader to become a, you know, a reader. And once they become a reader, that will improve their comprehension and understanding as well. So that's just to wrap it all up and sum it all up. You know, refer back to your standards as a teacher, teacher candidate. We are trying to practice now, practice what we preach and learn. So thank you all.
Thank you so much, Antoinette.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Taylor Hammonds.
I'm Takiya Broder.
I'm Rena Coates.
And our author was Jacqueline Woodson. We would like to start out with an icebreaker, asking you guys, have you ever picked up a book you could not put down when you were younger? Dr. Clinton?
No.
You want to ask that question?
It was very interesting, and I could relate to it. And I just could not put it down because I wanted to keep reading the
back
to the end. I wanted to know
what's
gonna happen
at
the end.
Do you know
what's
the title of the book?
Oh, I can't.
Leave it alone. Okay, thank you, Dr. Clinton. Thank you, Dr. Clinton. At the age of 6, Jacqueline started reading a book and it was called Match Girl. The book she could relate to her life because the book Match Girl was about a girl who was selling matches for her family. Jacqueline would read and read and read that book because she was like, she could relate to it. She read it so much that she was finally like, it doesn't have a happy ending. So she, because of that book did not have a happy ending, it caused her to want to start writing books that would have a happy ending.
All right, so as she stated in the book, she said that she wanted to change the world that the girl had to live. So therefore, when you have your students, you want to know what they're what's going on in their lives, so therefore you could pick a book that they can relate to or like.
Even though you want your students to have like different culture type books, you also want them to feel a connection from the book. So as Jacqueline stated, she wrote books because she wanted to influence other writers and she wanted to influence students to be to write. And she also said, she wanted them to find their own voice. So if you have any shy students or anything, they can find their voice through writing.
Any questions? Thanks for your time.
Thank you. Let's give the class a hand. Excellent.
You being actively engaged, as well as the students being actively engaged, kept them on task. And they were really, really connected. And you could tell that they were connected in their presentations and as they were working.
It's just, like you said, more the active engagement on Four Corners than any of the other strategies that we learned. Getting the students to be involved, student-led instruction, it makes a difference because we know what we know. We need to know what they know. And that's a great way to, for them to be able to show what they know.
One of the things I was wondering is how impactful might it be to have the question posted so that every time you're restating the question, you're restating it in the exact same way.
If you just stepped away from today's lesson, it's how could you assess how the three groups know or understood the authors that they didn't present on this topic. I felt this was a great way because it, you know, and this is something that I really starting to assess in my teaching is, I mean, yes, the content is good, but just as important is that we need to develop the critical thinking skills better.
As far as what I'd use in my classroom, or would be a good fit in my classroom, I think the Four Corners technique was interesting. And there was a lot of focus on racial diversity, but diversity means more than just race as well. It means religious and economic diversity. And, you know, these are things that could be brought up in a group discussion that, you know, you can have more than just racial diversity. And so those would be interesting things to bring up.
I love that we can come together in groups and build upon each other. And maybe with mine, they can really discuss ideas, make connections, and then bring it back out to one another. So we have more of a students learning from students.
One of the things that I really enjoyed was the beginning, because it's very important to activate students by having them internalize your message through what they already know. And we know that students do well when they're able to link new information to what they already know.
Every time you do a lesson, Dr. McKay, it reminds me of a previous lesson you presented and we learned about. And so, like, what I learned previous, I can use it for this lesson, plus what we learned today. And so when we took our little break or whatever, and I was just wondering, what if we had an active lesson, you know, lesson class like this? And I was thinking I'd be more comfortable with communicating, you know, speaking in front of crowds, as well as expressing myself too.
What we did today, all the previous lessons we did in class led up to today to have us sort of prepared, so we wasn't like freaking out. I enjoyed myself.
For one, this is my first time presenting in front of a crowd like this, and honestly, I didn't expect myself to be this comfortable. I thought I was gonna freeze, but honestly, it is life-changing because I'm glad you did keep repeating the question because we were busy and we would have forgot. So honestly, it was really good, to be honest.
I thought that another thing that I would like to see is maybe some split time. I called it compare and contrast. And so once you finish with your group, then you would go and visit another group of your choosing, and then you would compare and contrast why you chose one over the other technique. And so I thought that was good. But I thought overall it was good, and it helped me to even think about, from an administrative perspective, how I could work with professionals in, I guess, in the like faculty, working with faculty, pairing and sharing. I think the students, you did an awesome job today. Dr. McKay, you did very well, and also our observers and knowledgeable others. I'm intrigued by what I heard today. Thank you.